Thank you very much, Michal. And before I start my lecture, I'd like to thank YR Association and the organizers, Piotr, Michal, Marcin, for your kind invitation. It's really a pleasure and an honor to be lecturing here as keynote. And I'd like to thank you all to have resisted until the very last talk and the end of already long, sandy day with talks, and I hope you will not regret. As Michal already introduced, I am a professor at the Faculty of Economics at the University of Porto, where I am also a member of the Laboratory of Artificial Intelligence and Decision Support. This work we present today is a joint work with my co-author, Pedro Eduardo Silva, which is at Catholic, Portuguese Catholic University at Porto. As it has been mentioned, this concerns the analysis of the so-called symbolic data, and I'll let you know what we mean by that, but in very general terms, it means data that represents that contains intrinsic variability, that does not represent one single value, one single observation, but rather a set, a concept, a class, for which the variability inherent to this class or set or concept is to be taken into account in the data representation and analysis. In this talk, I will focus more precisely on the analysis of interval data, and then see how what methods we have developed for its analysis within the R framework. Okay, the outline of the talk is as follows. So I'll start by explaining what we mean by variability in the data and motivates why it should be taken into account. Then how this led to the definition of new types of variables, of descriptors that are called symbolic variables, that extend the usual numerical and categorical variable types. And then we'll be today especially interested in the interval valued variables. For this type of variables, we have proposed parametric models, which then allow for estimation, for which we provide estimation methods, and also addressing the problem of robust estimation and particular of interval outlier detection. What is an interval outlier? Once we have estimated the models, we are then in position to proceed with the multivariate data analysis, and we have developed methods for the analysis of various linear and quadratic discriminant analysis and model-based clustering for interval data. All this is implemented in an R package, which is available for you at the CAN, and then I'll finish with some concluding remarks. So variability in the data. In what we now call classical or standard data analysis, data, multivariate data is usually represented in a data array or n rows times p columns matrix, where each of n, let's call individuals, units, is associated or takes one single value for each of the p variables. These variables may be numerical, discrete, or continuous, or maybe categorical, with or without an order, like in this example describing flies arriving at some given airport. Okay, of course the values of the variables may be not known, may be missing, but still one value should be there. But this is not the case when we want to take into account variability. Symbolic data analysis developed a framework for taking into account variability inherent to the data, which occurs, for instance, where instead of describing flights, like here, we want to describe the airlines as a whole. So taking into account all the information for all the flights we have observed for each given airline. Or in a marketing application, when we have data on many individual purchases, but we want then descriptions of the clients. So for each client, taking into account information of all purchases that have been recorded in the past. Or in official statistics, where data is generally obtained from the citizens with extensive surveys, but we want to have descriptions or to have the analysis not of the individual citizens, but of cities, regions, sociographic groups of some type of interest, and not of the individual citizens. In all those cases, the so-called microdata, the data recorded at the first level, must be aggregated to obtain the appropriate descriptions of the units which are of interest, units at second level, like the airlines in the case of flights and not individual flights, like the regions in the case of official statistics and not individual citizens, like the clients and not each individual purchases, or like hospitals and not each individual patients, and so on. To take into account the intrinsic variability, the symbolic variable values will not be one single number or one single category, but will be finite sets, intervals in the case of numerical variables, or more generally distributions, if possibly empirical distributions, over an underlying set of subintervals for the quantitative case or categories for the qualitative case. We say that in this case of aggregated data, we go from microdata to macrodata, the data at the second level. And then you may ask yourself, but this problem is not new. I mean, these situations for sure arise in the past. For sure, people have been analyzing data at aggregated level for long. But what was meant by aggregating was taking some central statistics, like considering mean values, or considering medians if you want to be a bit more robust, or considering modes for the categorical variable. And then proceed with description of data just in the classical framework where you have one value in each cell of your data array. The problem is that with that simple solution of computing just a mean, a median, or a mode, you lose all the information of the intrinsic variability of your class or of your set or of your region, of your set of clients, of your set of purchases, or whatever you want to describe. Next. So, examples of what it means. So, suppose in the example of flights, you have descriptions of many individual flights, indicating which airline they correspond to, number of passengers, delay upon arrival, type of aircraft, and so on and so forth. And if you then do a temporal aggregation, it is after a certain time period of interest, you aggregate all this data, you may come up to a description of each individual airline by, for instance, depending on the user choice, the range of the number of passengers in the corresponding flights, or the empirical distribution of the delay upon arrival, or the distribution of categories of the type of aircraft. And here, this table should be read for airline A, the flights observed in the period of interest, the number of passengers in the corresponding flights ranged from 180 to 300 passengers. The delay upon arrival was in one third of the cases below 10 minutes, one third of the cases between 10 minutes and half an hour, and the remaining cases between half an hour and 1 hour. And in two thirds of the cases, the flights were taken by Airbus, and the remaining one third is for Boeing aircraft. Okay, so this is the description of the airline in the corresponding period, taking into account the distribution or the range of values of the corresponding flights observed by this airline. And the same for the other airlines. And this is what we call a symbolic data table. And the aim of symbolic data analysis, which has been developed now for the past 30 years, is to represent appropriately and design methods to analyze this type of data, without reducing it to just a table of mean values. Another such case is when you have data at a certain disaggregated level, like here, and this is data on different cities in the United States. This is official data like the per capita income, percentage of poverty in each community, number of persons per occupied house, percentage of kids living with parents, and so on. So describing individual communities. But if the aim is to describe not each individual community, but to compare the states, then the data has to be aggregated at state level, taking into account all the values observed in all communities in each given state. And you get a description of the states. In this case, everything was numerical, and the choice was to aggregate it by taking maximum and minimum, so then to obtain a table of interval. Okay. At this point, I'd like to stress the fact that interval data also arises in a context of fuzzy data analysis. Fuzzy data is also represented often by intervals, but in that case, the intervals have a different meaning. In fuzzy data, an interval represents the imprecision that I have as to where the value lies. In symbolic data, in our case, the interval does not represent any imprecision. It represents variability because I'm describing something which is not one single observation. Okay. Another source of such type of data, and this is a bit for the fun of it, is when you can have directly descriptions of concepts, like a description of animal species and not a description of a specimen. So in this example, if you are not describing one particular dog, not my dog or the dog of my neighbor, but you are describing the species of a dog. And of course, for the species of a dog, they are, of course, not all equal. They vary a lot. The type of coat varies between single and double. The vision range in dogs may vary between 500 and 900 meters. The hearing frequency varies. The number of smell receptors varies and so on. Describing a species, you are describing all dogs. It's a scientific description of what a dog is. And it takes into account all dogs that exist, have existed, or will exist in the future. Okay? So this is symbolic data. So this led, as you have seen, to data tables which have a different aspect as compared to the data arrays that we are used to analyze. So this led to the need to define new variable types. And in addition to the classical that we now call single valid variables, both for the numerical and the categorical case, we now have multivalued variables, interval variables, histogram variables, and categorical model variables. So multivalued variables when a finite set of values is associated with each observation, interval variables when an interval of real numbers is associated with each unit, histogram and historical model variables when the distribution is associated with each unit. So if we call Y our variables, Y is as usual defined as a mapping that to each unit under analysis associates some observed value. Value now taken into the broad sense of the term. The classical case are now the single valid variables where B and O are the same, O being in the underlying set, say real numbers, categories, whatever. For multivalued variables, the observation set is now the power set of O, so the variable takes finite sets of values of the underlying set. Interval valid variables, the ones we will be most interested in today, the value for each observation is an interval of real numbers, and categorical model, for the categorical case of histogram variables, B is a set of distributions on a set of subintervals or a set of categories, like here. So if we go back to our example, here the number of passengers is an interval valid variable, delay upon arrival is an histogram variable, the type of aircraft is a categorical model variable. I have an empirical distribution on a finite set of categories. So today we'll be interested most in the analysis of interval valued variables, like the number of passengers here or this here. So interval valued variables. So interval-valued variables, this means that to each unit of the set under analysis, I associate an interval. It's usually represented by its lower and its upper bound. So our data array is, as usual, n rows, one for each unit, p columns, one for each interval variable, and so that each unit is now represented by a vector in the broad sense, a vector of intervals. And this is what the data looks like. So again, you have a data array, units in rows, variables in columns, but in each cell we have not one single value, but an interval. At this point, you might say, why don't you just double the columns? Use one color for the minimum for the lower bounds, one color for the upper bounds, and you are back in the classical model and proceed. this would not be a good idea, because if we do that, you are just going from p variables to 2p, and you lose the connection between the minimum and the maximum. I mean, you can do that for a practical purpose, but you should never forget that the lower and upper bounds are values of the same variable. They are the limits of the observations of that same variable. Okay, so this should be taken into account. So next, so this another example. If you record the time people need to go to work, of course this varies from day to day. It was the example before for the number of passengers in flights for different airlines. Interval data occur a lot in meteorological contexts, where usually we are given mean and maximum temperatures at different meteorological stations. This is what is usually recorded and provided. It's minima and maxima, like represented here. Also pluviosity, another, this is an example I'll use later. Pluviosity minimum and maximum during the year of in different meteorological stations. It also occurs a lot in both description of both animal or botanical species, specific diseases, description of diseases. When you say you have a person with a flu, you'll have a temperature raising between 37 and 38, I don't know, 38 degrees Celsius. Okay, so there's a variability, it's not one fixed value. Or machine specifications and this kind of thing. In this case, where data is provided already in the form of intervals and is not and the intervals are not obtained by an aggregation of the microdata, we say that we have native interval data. It's already available as such. Okay, it does not result from an aggregation. Okay, so now if we have data like this, how will we analyze it? What can we say? How can we proceed with statistical analysis? And in this work, we wanted to have statistical models, so we proceeded by proposing, by finding what would be an appropriate parametric model to represent interval data. So the interval data again. So because most existing methods, at least until this work started, there were already many distance-based methods like clustering, even principal components that were based on appropriate distances for interval data, and then proceed with classical methods like hierarchical clustering and so on. But we wanted at this point to be able to have some inference methodologies, so we needed some probabilistic models. Okay? Usually, when we represent interval data, we do represent it like we just saw in the examples before, by the lower and upper bound of the observed value. Okay? For modeling purposes, however, it may be preferable to use an equivalent parameterization to represent an observed interval by the midpoint and the range. Okay? Note that mean, max, midpoint, and range, any of these two are enough to represent an interval. Any pair, mean, max, with the mean and the midpoint, you know the max, with the mean and the range, you know the max, whatever. So any pair of these are enough, and we will prefer the representation of midpoint and range. Here is another example of descriptions of price of models of cars. And again, we are not representing or describing here the price of a single car that you see in a stand. It's the price of the car model, which varies from stand to stand, from city to city, from country to country. Okay? So for each given model, there are many cars on sale and the price varies. So here you have for all these 20-something models, the price, which can be represented by, of course, the midpoint, the central, but this is not enough. We may observe that the less expensive prices, less expensive models, the price tends to vary less. But this is not always the case. Note on the NSK here, which is already quite expensive, but the price does not vary too much. Okay, so we cannot just rely on midpoints to represent information. We need the ranges. And with midpoint and ranges, we have the complete representation of the interval. I will come back at some points to this data set and to the on the NS case. So remember that it was there a bit different from the rest. So the first model we have proposed, that we call the Gaussian model, so based on the normal distribution, consists in assuming a multivariate normal distribution for the midpoints and the logs of the ranges. So if we have p interval variables, so if you have 5 interval variables, then you come out with a multivariate distribution in dimension 10. Because you have the midpoints and the range. So for the logs, the midpoints and the logs of the range is multivariate normal distribution, which is usually defined by a mean vector and a variance-covariance matrix. And we can distinguish in the mean vector the means of the midpoint variables, the means of the log range, and in the variance-covariance matrix, the blocks that compare midpoints with midpoints, log ranges with log ranges, and that the cross the off-diagonal blocks that compare midpoints with log ranges. The advantage with this model is that we are back home somehow. We are again in a Gaussian setup, and all methods that were designed for based on the multivariate normal distribution can directly be applied, and this is what we'll do later on when I talk about multivariate methods. Considering that the intervals midpoints follow a normal distribution, interval midpoints are somehow location indicators of the intervals. So assuming a multivariate normal distribution somehow corresponds to the usual, to the frequent normal assumption for multivariate data, considering the log transformation of the ranges allows to cope with each limited domain. Of course, the ranges can never be negative. And to assume a normal distribution for something that's not negative and not symmetrical, so we take the logs of the ranges. The limitation of this option is that we within this framework, we cannot treat degenerate intervals that collapse to one point. Okay? Now, this model, of course, implies that the marginal distributions of the midpoints is normal, that the marginal of the ranges is log normal, and therefore a specific relation between mean variance and skewness for the ranges. Trying to go a bit beyond the normal model and allowing for a bit more flexibility, we also consider a skew-normal alternative. These skew-normal distributions are a family of distributions that extend the usual, the normal, the distance, and so on by allowing for some skewness. So they include an additional shape parameter, which will allow to model some skewness. The skew normal generalizes the Gaussian and preserving some of its mathematical properties. So here are graphics of some skew normal. When alpha equals to zero in the center in pink, you have the Gaussian distribution. And if when alpha varies, negative or positive, you have a bit skewed distribution, so a bit more flexibility for this model. The density of the skew normal is known, and it depends on the density and of the p-dimensional standard Gaussian and the distribution function of the normal, of the standard normal distribution. So this is already known stuff. Now you could say, well, you had started by saying that we should not represent the interval by decomposing it into columns, mean and max, because we're losing the link between the two, the means and the max, if we do so. But now you are doing just the same, not using mean and max, but midpoints and ranges, and somehow taking two variables to represent the interval and missing the connection between the two. And I'm saying, well, we still, I have not forgotten that the midpoint and the log ranges will be values of the same variable. The variable is the same, like the number of passengers, okay? It's one single variable. So we'll model the link that might exist or not exist between the midpoints and the log ranges in this framework by considering specific parameterizations of this global covariance matrix, that is, by imposing conditions on the correlations. So apart from the usual setup, where you say that variables are not correlated at all, or that they can be correlated, we'll consider two intermediate setups. One is that the variables are not correlated, but within each variable, the midpoint can be correlated with the log range. This is often the case. Or alternatively, that midpoints of different variables may be correlated, the same for log ranges, but that there is no correlation between midpoints and log ranges, leading to, well, this is written here, but can see better here. So the usual thing is that you allow for everything to be correlated, or nothing is correlated, and the variance-covariance matrix is just diagonal. And then here, configuration two, the different interval valued variables are not correlated, but the midpoint and log ranges are still correlated. Or midpoints are correlated, log ranges are correlated, but there's no correlation between them. So you have four different types of variance-covariance metrics. We note that, well, this is full, this is diagonal, this has two diagonal blocks, and in this case, if I rearrange the columns and the rows, so that instead of having all midpoints, all ranges, I have midpoint log range, midpoint log range, midpoint log range for the same variables, it will be again a diagonal block matrix. Okay? So they are, in all cases, I can write it as block diagonal matrices. In the case two, I need to rearrange this. In case three, it's directly, and in case four, it's just one diagonal, nothing more. Of course, everything is a special case of one, and four is a special case of everything else. Why is this block diagonal structure important? Because it will give us easy conditions for maximum likelihood estimation of the model. So once we have either the Gaussian, the normal, or the skew normal model, I have to estimate parameters. I have data, I have interval data, so I have to say, okay, it follows a multivariate normal distribution. I have to say which mean values, which variance, covariance, we have to estimate. So the first estimation proposal is, as usual, by maximum likelihood. Maximum likelihood for the Gaussian model is, it follows, I mean, this is, these are the usual expressions, this is well known. Since the inverse of the variance-covariance matrix is symmetric, positive, definite, maximum likelihood of the mean is, as usual, the empirical mean, the observed mean. I mean, there's nothing new here. And so that the maximization of likelihood is, reduces to maximizing an expression like this. And here, I mean, everything, there's nothing new here. The fact that the variance-covariance matrix is diagonal, is block diagonal, the standard theory tells us that we can estimate in each block separately, and we are done. Okay, these are standard results. And so there's nothing new to do. The problem is solved with classical methodology, and we have both forms in all cases. Nothing new. For the skew normal model, this is a bit more difficult. For configuration one, no restrictions. The problem had been solved years ago by the proposals of the model, who can estimate so the location vector and the association matrix. For the restricted cases, we have to rely on a different parameterization. I won't go into details on more formulas here. So the skew normal model is usually represented by a location vector, an association matrix, and a shape parameter, which are not the mean vector, the variance, covariance, and the skewness, but they can be represented based on the traditional moments, and from there, using numerical methods, we can obtain numerical estimates of the parameters. Okay, this is much heavier, of course, because there's no closed form. It needs numerical optimization. Now, maximum likelihood estimation, as everybody knows, has one problem, is that if we have outliers in the data, the estimates you obtain will be much affected by these outliers, by this outlying value. So we have to address the problem of estimating robustly our method and detecting possible outliers that are there. But by outliers now we mean interval outliers, the observations are interval. And remember our car example? Here it's not the price, it's the engine capacity, but we see the same. If I represent the lead points here in the x-axis and the log ranges, again the Honda NSK and now also the Porsche stand out. But notice, they don't stand out because the midpoint is particularly low or particularly high. There are many other models who have the midpoint around these values, or even higher or much lower. They don't stand out either because of the log range. It's low, but so is the log range of many others. What is different about them is that the relation between the midpoint and log range is completely atypical. Okay, so they are a typical interval. Not a typical midpoint, not a typical log range. So again, if you represent it, you take into account just the midpoints, forgetting the information about the variability, you would completely miss it. Okay? So we have to proceed with methods for multivariate outlier detection. Typically, what do we know? Outliers are usually far from the center of the data cloud, so in a very general setup. So they are at a large distance from the center. The problem is that these distances, if they are, and usually this is evaluated using Mahalanobis distance, which depend on mean vectors variance covariance metrics. But now, if I estimate the mean vectors and variances and covariances using the outliers, of course, I will miss outliers because the distances will themselves be affected by the parameters that have been estimated with the outliers. So we need robust estimators to really understand what is a large distance and what is not a large distance. Okay. So outliers in multivariate interval data will be identified following these steps. We represent them using our model by midpoints and log ranges, assume a Gaussian distribution, so this outlier detection is only developed for the Gaussian model, use robust parameter estimation for the mean vector and the variance-covariance metrics, compute robust Mahalanobis distances based on this parameter, and then interpret multivariate outliers also based so on the quantiles of this distance and exploratory data analysis graphics. Robust parameter estimation, here again we have not invented anything. We use trimmed likelihood estimators. The idea is to remove from the maximum likelihood estimators those observations that would be unlikely to occur if the model was true. Okay? So we only use part of the observations for the estimation. And it's known that under a normality assumption, the minimum covariance determinant method and weighted trimmed likelihood lead to the same estimators. In our case, what we had to do was to extend this methodology to also take into account the restricted cases for the variance-covariance matrices, where the matrix is restricted. So this had to be, this was the particular case for the interval data. Also some refinements of trimmed likelihood estimator have been implemented, in particular using a two-step procedure, because in trimmed approaches you have to decide which percentage of the data will you remove. The 5% cases which contribute more to the maximum likelihood, or 10% or 20% or 30%, and how much. So what you do is, on the first step, take, as traditional it's the case, 50% or 75%, identify outliers, see what is the proportion of outliers, and then start again with this proportion, so in a two-step approach. Remember our cars? Here we have. So following this approach, And all variables considered, which were the prices, incapacity, acceleration, top shift of the cars and acceleration, outlier detection. So Mahalanobis distance, here is the cutoff that was obtained. Three models identified as clear interval, multivariate interval outliers. Beyond the NSK, we knew it, the Porsche, but also the Ferrari. So three. And a few more are almost borderline, but still much lower. So we know now how to estimate a model. So we have two models, how to estimate robustly in the Gaussian case, and how to use this to identify interval outlier data. And then, so now we have what we need to design multivariate methods which rely on parametric assumptions for the variables. And we have extended analysis of variance, discriminant analysis, and model-based clustering. So analysis of variance, just to recall, I think you all know, concerns the comparison of means of one or more numerical variables across some factors, so across two or more populations from which you have random samples, like here. You have different samples, which you call different samples from different populations which we call factor levels, like when we want to compare the mean value of sales of a given product in different shops, which would be the different populations. The null hypothesis being that the mean values are all the same, and the alternative that at least two populations, two shops, will provide different mean values. So in our case, for interval-valued variables, we have the Gaussian model, the skew-normal model, possible restrictions of the variance-covariance metrics, all this. So we rely on likelihood ratio approach. And so again, once we decide this, we may proceed. You remember that one variable is now two descriptors, one midpoint, one log range. So the analysis of variance, the one-way analysis of variance of for one interval variable, we always be a manoeuvre for the pair midpoint log range. Okay, so it's always a two-dimensional manoeuvre for the pair. So we maximize log likelihood for the null and the alternative hypothesis. Like it's known in general, the likelihood ratio statistics follow the syntactical AI square. And we can perform analysis of variance. If we want to take all interval variables into account, what we have to do is to do a MANOVA. If you have five interval variables, you'll have a MANOVA 10 dimensional. In each case, variable is double. This procedure showed under a simulation study that those tests had good power, two significance level approaching nominal levels when the constraints are indeed respected. The method assuming that the Gaussian, a Gaussian with the configuration one, so the non-restricted, has never performs worse than others, and that for using the skew-normal model, we need large samples. Okay, otherwise it does not work well. We apply this to a data set here, a meteorological data set of temperatures in China, temperatures observed in meteorological stations in China. Again, we are given min max in different years in different stations. And these meteorological stations belong to three different regions, north, northeast, and northwest of China. The full data table comprises 22 times 15 years, so 330 rows, and four columns of interval valid data. Applying all the models, we obtain that the 22 meteorological stations indeed belong to three different regions in China. Ah, yeah, this I already said. And the MANOVA says that the regions are indeed different. The method that better, the model that better fitted our data was the skew normal model with no restrictions in the variance covariance metric. But whatever the model adjusted, the conclusion would have been the same. Discriminant analysis relies on linear combinations of the variables. If we represent an interval by midpoint log range, we can directly extend discriminant analysis to our interval data setup. So for the Gaussian model, it's a directionalization of linear or quadratic discriminant analysis. In the first case, when you assume that the data, the groups are distinguished only in terms of the mean value. In the second case, when they are distinguished in terms of both the mean value and the variance-covariance matrix. For the skew normal model, you can consider three alternatives, that the groups differ in terms of the mean values plus variance covariances, all parameters, and we have just implemented the first one and the general one, where the groups are distinguished in terms of all parameters. The experimental results showed that these parametric rules outperform previous rules for discriminant analysis just based on distances. In homozygastic problems, of course, linear discriminant analysis performs best, as in the classical case. When you have large training samples and heterozygastic conditions, that is, the variances and covariances are different. Of course, quadratic methods are usually superior. But what is new? All this is known. I mean, it follows usual results. What is known new here is that when you have small samples and an heterozygastic setup, still a quadratic discriminant analysis can be the best choice, have the best performance in terms of error rates. And why? Because using restrictive configurations of the variance-covariance matrix, you can reduce dramatically sometimes the number of parameters to be estimated, and therefore you reduce the parameters in the, by considering restricted configurations of the variance-covariance matrix instead of imposing a false homozygous setup. Okay? And this showed to be a natural way of imposing constraints, and it was effective in reducing the expected error rates. And this one. Finally, model-based clustering, which performs clustering by considering that the data are a mixture. This has been done for the Gaussian case. And as usual, it's based on EM algorithm, using multiple starting points to avoid local optimum. The best configuration is, as it's often the case, and it's the default in our implementation, although others are possible, the model are identified by the best value of the BIC criterion. And here I just underline that what is usual, the criteria is usually used to define the number of components, that is the number of clusters. Here we use the BIC, not only to identify the number of clusters, but also the model that better fits the data. The Gaussian, which type of configuration. Okay, I had two applications. One, which data from the labor force survey in Portugal from like almost 10 years ago. And we had 1,540 cases. People were unemployed at the time of the survey, described by two variables, the activity time in years, so how long they have worked, and the unemployment time in months, so how long they have now been unemployed. And the microdata was aggregated. We want to describe groups by in terms of gender, region, age group, and education, leading to 58 sociological groups, which were our units of interest. So we had 58 described by interval data, and this is a biplot of interval data also obtained by the package. So now a biplot is not points, it's intervals in two dimensions, so it can be represented by rectangles, but we prefer this representation, which is the default one, by crosses. We obtain five classes, and we can just see that the classes are distinguished both in terms of the mean points and the log ranges. And moreover, that again, an heterozygastic setup was chosen in spite of the fact that the data set is quite small. And here is the parallel coordinates plot, which is an output. Okay. Second example was meteorological data that I showed at the beginning. Just quickly, this is just a a representation latitude longitude of the classes, meteorological data in the states, and the by plot. I'll jump these details. And finally, just to mention the R package, all these models, estimation, outlier detection, and all the methods are implemented in an R package called main data modeling and analyzing interval data, which is available in the CAN. It includes special data classes for interval data. The data may be provided already in the form of intervals by data frames of min, max, or midpoints and ranges, together with a factor that indicates how it should be aggregated, or min, max, midpoint, or range, so already in the form of intervals, or the microdata, together with a factor indicating how it should be aggregated. For aggregation, these are functions available. You can aggregate by min, max observed, or else to have a more robust aggregation by predefined quantiles on the observed state. You can aggregate by the 10% to the 90% quantiles, for instance. Once you have the interval data, the package includes functions for maximum likelihood estimation, robust estimation, outlier detection, and all that I mentioned, ANOVA discriminant analysis, and model-based clustering for the Gaussian model. This is the sketch of the package. Data frame, you may have an aggregating factor, you obtain e-data, high-data, high-data object. You may have a grouping that then is connected to the discriminant analysis or to ANOVA, model-based clustering for the estimation, to go quick. The iData class, the data is represented by midpoints and log ranges, which are data frames, names, characters, number of observations, number of variables. The usual R methods have been extended, so like plot, head, tail, print, summary, and so on, have been extended to this data class. And then we have, of course, developed the methods appropriate for the multivariate methods that have been designed. Okay, so we have shown a way to go in from microdata to macrodata by representing data by intervals, therefore allowing to take variability into account. Several methodologies have already been developed. In particular, we have presented parametric models that are specific for interval-valued variables, which then allow for model-based multivariate analysis of interval data. The implementation in R is in this package, which is now available in the CRAN, but interval data and the other types of symbolic data keeps raising new problems, because you cannot take for granted the results and the theorems and the properties of real data, the data that you are used to. Once you have data that goes beyond the usual model, now nothing can be taken for granted, and because the intervals or distributions are not real numbers. So it's a wide field for future research. Thank you very much.